And there's one more property which is very important that I want to point out, which is we say that we know that every such transformation, I mean, such transformations are classified into three types: elliptic, parabolic, and loxodromic. In particular, loxodromic elements have each two fixed points. One is attractive, one is repelling. Okay? And one very important property of this limit set is that it is the, when the group is non-elementary, you have infinitely many loxodromic elements. And in that case, each has two fixed points. Each loxodromic element has two fixed points. They are part of the limit set. And you have that lambda is the closure of the set of fixed points of loxodromic elements. Okay. Yeah, I don't know. Okay, sorry. Okay, so this is very, very beautiful. This means that whenever we have a discrete group of isometries of hyperbolic tree space, we have the solid ball, three-dimensional ball. Disk of dimension 3, which the inside is the hyperbolic space when we keep it with the hyperbolic metric. Then when we have a discrete group, we have this group of transformations acting on the compact ball. Inside, you have an action by isometries. Outside, on the boundary, you have the limit set. So you have this limit set, which, as we saw, can be quite wild. I mean, it's a closed invariant set with a very, very rich geometry. It can be in a fractal set. It can be very complicated. Can have infinitely many components and so on. But even so, you have this family of transformations on the two sphere, on the boundary sphere, for which this closed set is an invariant set. The complement is also an invariant set. Here is where the dynamics concentrate. In the closed set, every orbit is dense. In the complement, the action is mild, it's properly discontinuous. You have a continuity. So if you look at the complement, that is the paradigm for complex geometry. When you look at the complement and you take the quotient by the action, you have a Riemann surface, very nice geometry with a projective structure, very nice geometry. And then when you look at the limit set, you have very, very, very rich dynamics. Okay? So this has been studied for more than a century, many fantastic theorems, and still many things are being done. We've heard very, very interesting talks now in this by Bertrand, by Todd, by many people about still this very rich subject, which is studying geometry and dynamics associated to discrete groups of this space. It's a fantastic subject. There's also something which is very, very relevant, which is this dictionary, Sullivan and McMullen dictionary, which you have. So Kleinian group is at the end. You have a collection of Mobius transformations, and they generate a group. Each one has a very simple dynamics. But when you have several of them and you combine them, you have very rich dynamics, very rich geometry. So you have Kleinian groups in one side. And you can also consider, instead of this, you can consider, as in Romain's lecture, one rational map of degree, at least two, and all its iterates. That forms a semigroup. And you have a rational map. And So here you have the limit set and the complement, which is the region of equicontinuity. Here you have the Julia set and the complement, which is the FAT2 set. And this dictionary tells you that, roughly speaking, ideas and results in one side correspond to ideas and results in the other side. It's not a perfect dictionary. Not every sentence has a translation, but in general, you do have a translation, and many, many important results have come like that. So, for example, yesterday we heard about this non-wandering domain theorem by Dennis Sullivan. That is the translation, so to say, to this side of the dictionary of the Alford Fagnatis theorem here. And so many things come like this. And so we have all this rich, fascinating theory. And in 1996, Alberto Berkowski was a professor in Lille, France, and we brought him for 1 year to Mexico to start our new center in that by that time, and we started with a year in dynamical systems, and he was lecturing about iteration theory in several complex variables. Okay. So this is in one complex variable. And then he started lecturing about the work of Fornais and Siboney in several complex variables. And then the natural question that came to us was, well, and what should there be in this side of the dictionary in several variables? Is there something like Kleinian groups in several complex variables? Okay, we didn't know much at the time. Then Fornais came to Mexico about a month or two, and by the time we talked to him, and he said that he didn't know much all the time, but it should be an interesting topic. So we started working precisely on something like Kleinian groups in several complex variables that we call complex Kleinian groups. So by this we mean a discrete subgroup of PSL M plus 1 C. This is the group of automorphisms of complex projective space of dimension n, which acts on CPN with non-empty region of discontinuity. Okay. So when you have such an object, somehow you have a similar splitting to what I said. You have complex projective space, and if you have something like a limit set where the action concentrates, you have the complement where you can do geometry. So we started working on this object, and many questions, natural questions, arose. Is or should be the notion of limit set under interesting families. Many more questions. I can say that now we have several answers. Tomorrow I will focus on complex dimension 2. In the complex dimension 2, now we are starting to have a good basic setup. But so far I can say that almost any question you make is an open question. Of course, this group is a SLNC plus 1C is a semi-simple group, and we are talking about basically lattices or discrete subgroups of semi-simple groups. That's a classical theory. There's a lot known in that setting. So it's a very deep theorems. So you have all that general machinery. But then when you come down to studying something like limit sets, where the action is properly discontinuous, quotients of the region of discontinuity, properties of the limit sets, and so on, that's almost a subject which is very much in its childhood. And that's what I try to focus for today and tomorrow. I'm studying that. Okay, so first about this thing of the notion of the limit set. As Alberto explained to me 20 years ago or something like almost, there's really not in general one single notion that works in all contexts of limit set. At the end, definition is just a definition. You can define what you want, provided you can prove something interesting with it. Okay, and so this same question of what should be the limit set of a discrete group action on some space is a question that Ravi Kulkarni addressed in the 1970s, I think, in a paper in Invenzione. And he defined a concept which is pretty good for us in this setting, which we now call the Kulkarni limit set. I will define it in a moment. But before, let me give a brief discussion of why should we bother? Why don't we take just the same definition? I mean, in the classical setting, it's just the set of accumulation points of the orbits. Why don't we do that? Okay, of course we can do it. But let me give you an example. I'll give first an example that Ravi gives in his paper in R2, and then I'll give an equivalent example in the projective space. Okay? In R2, it's just like the map from R2 into itself, which carries xy into 2x, 1/2 of y. Very simple map on automorphism. You take all the iterates and the inverse and the iterates of the inverse, you have a cyclic group, a representation of the cyclic group as a group of transformations in the plane. Now, what are the orbits? You have, obviously, the axes are invariant sets, okay? And all orbits in future time, they move like this. So you are expanding in this direction, contracting in this direction. So all orbits behave like this. Orbits along the y-axis converge to the origin. In this axis, they converge to infinity in the past, but they converge to the origin going backwards. So which is the set of accumulation points of the orbits? Just the origin. Or infinity, if we really think of it in S2. Okay? So for the classical definition, this would be our limit set. Why not? Okay, well, there's something which is not so nice of this definition. Take, for example, one circle, any circle around the origin, and look at the orbit of that circle. Not backwards here. Okay. So the orbit of this circle under this group action will accumulate at both axes. So the action is not properly discontinuous on the complement of the origin. So of course you can call this the limit set if you want, but you will not have the nice property that the action outside the limit set is mild in some sense. Okay? It's not such a... So it's not a really good notion. Now, if we want to do it in our setting, in projective setting, you can do it very nicely. For example, in PSL 3C, consider the element represented by a matrix of the form lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3, 0, 0, where the lambda norm of lambda 1 is more than the norm of lambda 2, is more than the, is greater than the norm of lambda 3, is greater than 0. Okay? Now, each of these gives you an eigenspace in R3, in C3. When you come down to CP2, you have each of these gives you a fixed point in CP2. Okay, so you have three fixed points. One is attractive, another is repelling, one is a saddle, just because of the norm of the eigenvalues. Okay, now each 2 points, which are in projective space, give you a line. So you have three invariant lines. So this one is repelling, this one is a saddle, this one is attractive. Okay? And then it's an exercise to show that, well, these are the three fixed points. Now, these two lines, one is attracting, the other is repelling. And if you take the inverse matrix, you replace one is repelling, the other one is attractive. This one doesn't play such an important role. It's not obvious. But okay, and you can see the several things. One, the action, if you just look at CP2 minus the 3 points, the action is not properly discontinuous here, neither it is equicontinuous. Okay? Now, if you remove the 2 lines, then the action is properly discontinuous and equicontinuous on the complement. Okay? But if you remove 1 line and the opposite point, so to say, you also have an action, the action is also properly discontinuous on the complement. Or if you remove this line and the opposite point, the action is properly discontinuous. So in these cases, we see that there is not one largest region where the action is properly discontinuous. There are 2 possible, and none contains the other. None of them coincides with the region of equicontinuity. None of them is a set of accumulation points of the orbits. So all the properties I listed of the limit set somehow break down here, in this very simple example. Okay, so what is the limit set? Okay. Then Ravi gave one definition, which has several interesting properties. One is the definition which is canonically defined always. 2, you always have that the action on the complement is properly discontinuous. It's not always the largest region where it is properly discontinuous, as in this example, but the action in the complement is properly discontinuous. You have always fundamental domains, and you have a nice candidate up there. Let me give the definition. So you have a group. Let me restrict to the setting of complex groups of complex automorphisms, but this is a much more general definition. So you have the limit set that we denote by lambda q is lambda naught union L1 union L2, union of 3 sets, where L naught is the closure of set of points with infinite isotropy. So, for example, in this case, this is the origin. In this example, L naught is the origin. So, in the example, this is just the origin, which is a fixed point for the whole group. It has infinite isotropy. Then, L1 is the closure of set of accumulation points of orbits of points in Cpn minus L naught. Okay? So, for example, in this case, if you remove the origin and you take, for example, orbits here, they will accumulate at the origin. And this is the only one. So in this example, this is again just the origin. But this is not always like this. There are examples in which this one is containing here, examples in which this one is containing here, examples where they are different. All kinds of things can happen. And then finally, L2 is the closure of accumulation points of orbits of compact sets in Cpn minus L naught union L1. Okay. So when you take this, you are forcing the action on the complement to be properly discontinuous. You are removing the set where you can have problems. So if you come to this set, then lambda two, in this example, is the union of the axis. So in this example, the Kolkarni limit set is just the union of the two axes. In the example I gave before, in this projective example, the Kolkarni limit set is the union of these two lines. Okay, so now here's a definition. So what? So today I try to convince you that one, this subject is, I think, interesting. This is an interesting concept. But at the same time, there are many complications and things which are strange and which we still don't understand, especially in higher dimensions. And then tomorrow I will focus on dimension 2, in which we will see that this is the good notion in complex dimension 2. Okay? So for the rest of today's talk, I will consider various families of groups in PSL NC and see what happens. Okay, so the first case is cyclic groups. In other words, you have one transformation and you iterate it backwards and frontwards. Okay, and see what happens. So just a remind, let us remind that in PSL2C, the elements are classified are elliptic, parabolic, loxodromic. There are many ways to do this classification. I said it before using Mobius transformations, and I said that they were, every Mobius transformation was conjugate to one of the form, either set goes to set plus one or set goes to lambda times set, and then yes. Yes. Yeah. Stopping in L2, you already can grant that the action on the complement is properly discontinuous. Okay? Now, if you put more conditions, you get different sets. Your question is very, very, very appropriate, because we will see by the end of today's lecture that this concept of limit set gives you a very, very interesting limit set, which is very good in many cases, But there are some cases in which it is clear that we need something more refined. Okay, this is still a concept that applies always. So if it applies always, you are likely to be missing something. Okay, so we will see that in certain cases, you need something more refined. I'll come to that later. Okay? Yeah. Not, there is not such as an extension, but there are natural ways of embedding PSLNC in PSLN plus 1C and so on, which is somehow the equivalent of the extension. One natural way is what Unaka construction that we call suspension. Yeah. Yeah.
But for
A,
even you don't even
have this other boundary thing. Yeah. 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 I mean, that's a very important point. I mean, many of the properties we have in real hyperbolic geometry and so on are proved by using that the boundary ball, the boundary sphere is the boundary of the hyperbolic space. And then you use the inside to prove things about the outside. Here you cannot use that. And for an odd, it is a boundary, but there is not a natural, it's not something like the sphere bounding the ball, bounding hyperbolic space. Okay? So in this case, you can go from automorphisms of CPN to automorphism of CPN plus one. But there's not really one something canonical as Poincaré's extension. Example, sorry?
It is L1.
In that example? L1 is... L0 union L1 is the usual limit set, the set of accumulation points of orbits. L0 is the closure of the set of the points with infinite isotropy. Then you remove that. You look at the complement, and you look at the orbits of points in the complement, and you see where they accumulate. Okay? So those two together would be the usual set of accumulation points of the orbits. Well, then you have to add L2 in this definition. Okay?
So the closure of lock strong fixed points, were totally lock strong.
Yeah. Okay, so now let's see this example. So in PSL2C, we have this classification. There are many ways. So we know that elliptic elements have two fixed points, and none of them is neither attractive nor repelling, and one is conjugate to the other. This one have only one fixed point. This one have two fixed points, one repelling, one attractive, in the limit set. Right, okay? And we also know that in this case, every matrix A, B, I mean, every element here has a lifting to SL2C, and every such matrix can be taken to a Jordan form of type 0, 0, 1, or lambda, lambda. Sorry? Oops. Yes. Thank you. Yeah. Okay. In this case, you have parabolic. In this case, you have either elliptic or loxodromic, depending. If the norm of lambda is 1, you have elliptic. Otherwise, you have loxodromic. Okay? Well, then you can go in general. Cyclic groups in PSLNC. You can define elliptic if it, G, element G, is elliptic if it has a lifting to SLNC. Such that, which is diagonalizable, and all eigenvalues have norm 1. Okay? Then you can say it's parabolic if has a lifting. Which is non-diagonalizable, and eigenvalues have norm 1. And loxodromic otherwise. That means it has a lifting which is diagonalizable or not, but at least one eigenvalue has norm different to 1. Okay? And then this is a definition which extends the classical definition for elements in PU N1. And this was given for a Mexican colleague, Navarrete, for N equals 3, and by Angel Cano and Loesa for N bigger than 3. And then they prove, you can prove theorem. It's elliptic. If and only if the Kolkarni limit set is either empty or the group is non-discrete. Yes, exactly. Then parabolic, if and only if the Kolkarni limit set of the group generated by this element consists of one single projective subspace of CPN. Loxodromic, if and only if the limit set consists of two projective subspaces of CPN, which can be of different dimensions. CPNs, CP case of K is smaller. Yeah. So, subspace. So, for example, in the case of PSL3C, this guy can consist of either two lines or one line and one point. In principle, it could be 2 points, but that doesn't happen. Okay? So, we have this. Now, let me give another family of very interesting examples that will bring us closer to the next lecture by John. So another family is complex hyperbolic groups. So we are looking at subgroups G containing PU N1. So this also brings us closer to Todd's lectures. He was considering the real case, which is naturally a subgroup of PSL M plus 1 C. So these are, without the P, these are the automorphisms of projective space that preserve a quadratic form of signature N, 1. Okay? So what you have in that setting is you have projective space, CPN. Then if you look at the null vectors in CN plus 1, so if you look at, so here you are preserving the quadratic form Z naught square plus Z1 plus Zn square minus Zn plus 1 square. So you're preserving, you're looking at linear maps which preserve this quadratic form. Well, or an equivalent one. Let me take this one, this model. So if you look at the points where this is equal to 0, the null vectors, and you projectivize, what you get is a sphere. So you have a sphere of dimension 2n minus 1. Now, if you look at the negative vectors, where this is less than this, you get the inside of the ball. And that is the model for complex hyperbolic geometry. Okay? And then the transformations, these elements are the holomorphic isometries of this ball with the Bergman metric, the complex hyperbolic metric. Okay? But they are, so you are acting on the whole complex space preserving this ball. But here is by isometries, outside is not by isometries. In predictive space, you have a canonical metric, which is the Fubini study metric, but these maps do not preserve that metric. Okay? What about the limit set? Well, we can forget about the rest. We can just look at complex hyperbolic space. We have a group of transformations there, and you can just focus your eyes on complex hyperbolic space. That's very, very interesting, very rich. And you can do, as in the classical case, you look at points inside, you look at orbits of points, you are acting by isometries in the inside, so the orbits will accumulate in the boundary, and you will have a limit set on the boundary defined in the usual way, at the set of accumulation points of the orbits. Okay? That is somehow the usual limit set, and we call it the Chen-Greenberg limit set of the group, because they studied it first in this complex case. Okay? But when you do, and that limit set has all the properties of the limit set in complex in real hyperbolic geometry. It either consists of one or two points or infinitely many points. It's a minimal set, it's closed, invariant. The action in the complement is the largest open set where the action is properly continuous. It has all the nice properties if you focus your eyes on the complex hyperbolic space and its boundary. But if now you remember that you are actually acting on complex hyperbolic space, on complex projective space, and you want to see the action on the whole space, then perhaps you are missing something. Okay? And in fact, for example, when n equals 2, and when n equals 3, n equals 2, so you are acting on CP2, and you consider, for example, a group here, which is a lattice, and this limit set is the whole tree sphere, then the action in the whole complement is minimal. Okay? So the action is very far from being properly discontinuous on the complement, as far as saying that every orbit is dense in the complement. Okay? So this notion, when you look at the action on the whole complex projective space, is not such a good notion. Here, so here you can consider, for example, what about the Kulkarni limit set? Okay? And to describe that set in this setting is very beautiful. We can do the following. Look at one point in the sphere. This is a codimension one sphere here. Okay? The time at each point, if you can take one point, arbitrary point, you look at the tangent space of the sphere, that it's real, it has real dimension 2n minus 1. And so there is one unique projective hyperplane of complex dimension n minus 1, which is tangent to the sphere at this given point. Okay? So at each point, you have a unique projective hyperplane tangent to the sphere at the given point. Now, if you now look at the limit set, Chen-Greenberg limit set, and you look at that tangent hyperplane at each point, this set is invariant under the action. The action is by holomorphic transformations. So the tangent space at each point moves to the corresponding tangent space, tangent projective hyperplane. So the union of all these projective hyperplanes at points in the Chen-Greenberg limit set is a closed invariant set. Theorem, that is the Kulkarni limit set. Okay? So in this case, we have G, subgroup of P, U, N, 1, discrete. Lambda, C, J, contained in sphere. Okay. Chain, Greenberg, limit set. For each x in this guy, let L x be the projective n minus 1 plane tangent to the sphere. X. Then the Kolkarni limit set is the union of all these x's for x in this unit set. And two here in this case you have all the nice properties. The complement equals CPN minus lambda cool is the largest region where the action is properly discontinuous. So in this case, there's a unique action and a unique largest such region, and it is this one. Yes. Yeah, you're right. And assume this set, this group, has cardinality so that the group is non-elementary. Yes. Thank you. And finally, this region is the equicontinuity region. Okay, so and you have more interesting properties in this example. So just let me say that what do I mean by what? No, the omega cool is it is the set of all points in projective space where the action is equicontinuous, regarded as a family of transformations of projective space. Okay? So it's like the equivalent of the Fatou set. Okay, so just let me say that this theorem, again, was proved by Navarrete about 10 years ago for n equals 2. Then Cano and myself proved something in higher dimensions. We proved we could improve this part. We proved this, that the complement of this set was the region of equicontinuity. It was proved by Angel Cano and myself. And now there's a recent article by Cano, Liu, Bing, Juan and Marlon, I think, proving this result. And this is Angel Cano will speak next week about the proof of this result. Okay, so this is fairly recent. And now let me come to another type of examples, which is where we started. This is something I did with Alberto Verkhovsky. Myself in 1990s, late 90s, which is here we use something which has a big word, twist of theory, but what I'll do is very, very elementary. We don't need twister theory for this, but it's actually very, very beautiful geometry. So remember, yesterday we saw that. Remember that CP1 is S2, okay? And how we proved it? We made a drawing. We put C, then we put a copy of the complex here, numbers, and then we took a point here that was a line through the origin. That line meets this complex line in one point, and then you define a map that to this element here, you associate this element here. Okay? And then you have to add one point from when you come to that. Okay? And that gives you this well-known diffeomorphism. Now let's keep the drawing, but let's make a minor change. Now we put the quaternions. And we put a copy of the quaternions. So that is C2 with some additional structure, or R4 with more additional structure. Okay? And now you consider quaternionic lines. Now watch it. You have to, what is a quaternionic line? If you are in R8, this is R8. A real line means you take one vector and you multiply by all real numbers. And you multiply by left or right, it doesn't matter. Complex line, you take one vector and you multiply by all complex numbers. Quaternionic line, you take one vector and you multiply by all quaternions. But then you have to choose, you multiply either by the left always or by the right always. You like what?
Politics.
Yeah, yeah. Well, Mexico is more mixed, no? Yeah, but we'll discuss that. Yeah. Okay, so let's suppose we consider left quaternionic lines. Okay. Let's see if it works. If not, we'll change to right. Okay, so now take a one quaternionic line. This is a four-dimensional real plane. You have another four-dimensional real plane. They meet transversally in exactly one point. And you do this for all quaternionic lines, and you get something which is what? On the one side, you have CH1, the quaternionic projective space. You get what? HP1. Sorry. You see, that's the problem with the left. Okay? Okay. So you have the quaternionic projective line. And what do you have in this side? What is this? You are having R4 union one point. And what is that? So we'll get that the quaternionic projective line is nothing but the four-dimensional sphere. Okay? But notice that we have more. Each quaternionic line, and a quaternionic line means that you have one vector and you multiply by all quaternions. Okay? Now, what happens if you have the same vector but you multiply only by the complex numbers? You have a complex line contained in that quaternionic line. Okay, and if before that you rotate slightly, you move your vector in the quaternionic space, and you multiply by quaternions, you get another line. By complex numbers, you get another line. Okay, so if you see this quaternionic line is actually a copy of C2, and if you remove the origin, it is naturally filled by complex lines through the origin. Okay? Now, if in C4, if you think of this as being C4, and you collapse each each complex line is containing a unique quaternionic line. Okay? Now, if you collapse all complex lines, each complex line is collapsed to a point, you get CP3. Okay? Now, if each quaternionic line is collapsed to a point, you get S4. And you have a natural projection. Okay? Each point here is in a unique complex line. That complex line is containing a unique quaternionic line, so you project to the corresponding point here. Well, this is the so-called twist of vibration, or also called the Calabi-Penrose vibration for different reasons. Okay? Now, it's a locally trivial vibration. Which is the fiber over each point? One point here represents a quaternionic line. Which is the fiber? The space of all complex lines in that quaternionic line. So the space of all complex lines in a copy of C2. So the fiber is CP1. Okay? So we have this beautiful vibration. So P3, fibers over S4 with fiber S2. Now, okay, now look now here. Now look at the conformal orientation-preserving conformal automorphisms of S4. This is the same, if you want, as isometries of real hyperbolic 5 space. But I don't want to think of it in this way. I want to think of this in this way. With a plus, yes. Yeah. Okay? Well, then you can show that this is the same as the space of all maps of the form AQ plus B. All the quaternionic Mobius transformations. That we'd like to write them as quotients, but since this is not commutative, if you were, you don't know what to do. So you better write it like this. CQ plus D to the minus 1. And with the A, B, C, and D quaternionic satisfying something. Okay, so this is something which is well known. Alfors has studied it also in Clifford algebra, Zeta, many people. Okay, so all the conformal automorphisms of the A4 sphere can be expressed in the terms of quaternionic Mobius transformations. But now see that each of these guys is a quaternion. So if you think that the quaternions are C2, at the end, each of these actually is a 2x2 complex matrix. Okay? So you can write this at the end as a matrix A, B, C, D, where each of these is a 2x2 complex matrix. So you have a natural embedding of this group into PSL4C. Okay? In other words, every conformal automorphism of the four-dimensional sphere is canonically a holomorphic transformation of CP3. And not only every transformation, but as a group, we have a canonical embedding. So whenever you have a group of isometries of hyperbolic 5 space, you canonically have a group of holomorphic transformations in CP3. Okay? Now, you don't know how it behaves up there a priori. Okay, so you have S4, you have CP3, you have the twist of vibration. Over each point, you have the corresponding fiber, which is called the twister line. And if you have a group acting here, this group has a canonical lifting here, which is taking fibers into fibers. Okay? here the action is conformal. So if you come here, you have an horizontal, at each point you have a horizontal space, and horizontally the action is conformal. What about in the vertical direction? And that's something we proved. This is an exercise. What we proved is that horizontally you're taking CP1s into CP1s. And then we proved that that action on the fibers is by isometries with respect to the usual round metric. Okay? So the action vector here is conformal in this direction, isometries in this direction. Then we, using that, you can show easily that the Kulkarni limit set of the action here is just the limit set here, and you take the inverse image. Okay? And you can say more, the Kulkarni limit set, the Kulkarni limit set here is just the pullback of the usual limit set here. And you have interesting properties, for example. This happens always. This is always. Now, for example, if the group is non-elementary, the action on the limit set here is minimal. When you lift it here, it may or may not be minimal. It is minimal if and only if up to conjugation. So you have conformal automorphisms of, let's say, S1. Here I mean the group of generated by inversions here. Well, let me put it this way. Let me say, you have isometries of H2, which embed in the conformal automorphisms of S2. So this, by Poincaré's extension, they embed in the isometries of H3, then isometries of H4, and so on. So this goes to isometries of S3, and then you go to isometries of S4. If the action on the limit set here is minimal, if and only if, up to conjugation, the group you have is Sariski dense here or here. Otherwise, the action is not minimal. Okay, so that allows you to see even more than what you see here. So all the conformal dynamics embeds here, and here you can see even more. So for example, a corollary of this is take the fundamental group of a compact hyperbolic five-dimensional manifold. Then it acts canonically on CP3 with dense orbit. Every orbit is dense in CP3. Okay, so it's... Now, to one more example, which is very simple.
So embedding there goes into PSU22, sitting inside
PSU22. Yes, probably yes. Yeah. Well, that was... Yes. Yeah. Well, it's very good. That's very close to what I will say now. Thank you. Now, again, coming to this setting, we have the projective space, CP3. We have S4. And we have the pistol lines. Observe the following. This is the inverse image of one point. If you remove this point and you remove this line, what you get is a locally trivial fibration over R4, which is actually trivial because R4 is contractible. So if you remove one line and the fiber, what you get left is nothing but R4 times S2. Okay? In other words, take one fiber and take a neighborhood of it. What is that neighborhood? That's S2 times a four-dimensional disk. And what is the complement? S2 times a four-dimensional disk. Okay, so this is very, very interesting. So if you take one twister line and you took a tubular neighborhood of it, that's like a mirror. That's splitting the projective space in two equal halves. Okay? So that makes you think on short key groups, okay? And in fact, this is for crystal lines. But now, if you take any projective line, you can find an element in PSL4C taking this projective line into this line. So whenever you have a projective line in CP3, you take any tubular neighborhood of it, its boundary splits projective space in two parts which are diffeomorphic, actually biholomorphic. Okay, so that's very interesting. Because now, for example, if we go here, we have a group acting on here and we're lifting it to projective space. So twistor lines going to twistor lines. Well, now perhaps you can just tilt the twistor lines a little and somehow you ought to have something similar. No? Well, that's a construction you can do always. So that's also something I did with Alberto. Now take in CP3, take two projective lines, arbitrary projective lines, which are pairwise disjoint. This corresponds to a two-plane in C4. This corresponds to a transversal two-plane in C4. It's easy to find a linear transformation taking this one into the interchanging these two lines. Okay? That's going to take a neighborhood of this one into a neighborhood of this one, a larger neighborhood into a larger neighborhood. There's going to be something in the middle which splits, which is an invariant set. Okay? And then under this transformation, the inside goes to the outside and the outside comes to the inside. And you have, in fact, many choices. There is not one map. It's not like in the spheres that if you have a collimation one sphere, you have a unique inversion. Here, you have something like inversions, but you have freedom. You have many choices. But I can choose this tubular neighborhood as thin as I want, and I can find a linear transformation taking this line into this one, and the inside into the outside, leaving the boundary invariant. Not fixed point invariant, but as I said, the boundary is invariant. So now we can play ping pong, table tennis. I give you a collection of pairs of lines, all of them pairwise disjoint. Okay? For each of them, we choose a linear transformation, interchanging them. Okay? And we choose the linear transformations so that the corresponding mirrors are very thin, are very, very close, say, to the pink lines. If we do that, we can assure that the corresponding group you get is a discrete group. You can control, you have a natural fundamental domain. You can control almost everything. And then in that case, you have a limit set, which is just the set of accumulation points of the lines that define the group. Okay? Now, this limit set, defined in this way, is a Cantor set times CP1. And the action in that limit set is transversally minimal. I mean, it is minimal in the set of lines. Okay? And well, you have many interesting properties about this thing.
We don't know that it's actually minimal
or not. No, we know that it is not always minimal.
We know that it's not always minimal.
Because that contains this particular case, and in this case, so it's not always minimal.
It's not generally minimal.
But we also... So the natural question we had was whether or not this limit set was the Kulkarni limit set. Okay? And a few months ago, I suggested to some of my younger colleagues that they should find such type of examples in PU31, because then you will have very nice groups of complex hyperbolic groups. The problem is with these young people is that they have no respect for the elders. And instead of proving what I told them to prove, they did just exactly the opposite. They proved that such groups do not exist. Okay? So all such groups are in PU22. Okay? This is a very recent theorem by Angel Cano, Vanessa Alderete, Mayra Mendez, and Carlos Cabrera. And there's going to be a poster about this next week. Okay? And something very, very remarkable. They also proved that in many cases, this limit set is the Kulkarni limit set. But they find explicit examples where it is not. This is examples where this is a proper subset of the Kulkarni limit set. This is smaller, but containing the other one. The action in the complement is properly discontinuous. But in those examples, the complement is not the region of equicontinuity. So there are things to be understood. And I think I will stop here.